Hi, my name is Patrick Boyle. Welcome to my YouTube channel. Today we're going to learn about variance swaps, a new derivative that we'll be looking at today. So a variance swap is an over-the-counter financial derivative which allows investors to trade future realized variance against current implied variance. Now, of course, today we're talking about variance swaps. Yesterday we did talk about volatility swaps, so you can watch that video as well. But how variance swaps work is they act like a forward contract on the future realized variance of a given underlying asset. The reason that variance is used rather than volatility is because variance, which is volatility squared, can be replicated with a static hedge. And so essentially these things are more traded than volatility swaps because they're easier to hedge. At inception of the trade, the strike is usually chosen such that the fair value of the swap is zero. Variance swaps allow investors to speculate on or to hedge risks associated with volatility. One leg of the swap will pay an amount based upon the realized variance of the price changes of the underlying product. Usually these price changes will be daily log returns based upon daily closing prices. The other leg of the swap will pay a fixed amount, which is the strike quoted at the deal's inception. Thus, the net payoff to the counterparties will be the difference between these two levels and will be settled in cash at the expiration of the deal. The long party receives realized variance and pays the strike variance at maturity, and the short party receives the strike variance and pays realized variance at maturity. The annualized realized variance is calculated based on a pre-specified set of sampling points over the life of the swap. Normally, an investment bank is the calculation agent for any variance swaps traded. The calculation agent usually has some discretion over whether a market disruption event occurs or the treatment of situations such as if a stock is delisted. This can lead to issues if an investor is long and short identical products versus two different investment banks. These problems are less of an issue if the counterparties are joint calculation agents. The profit and loss on a volatility swap relates only to the realized variance, which is volatility squared, of the underlying and is unaffected by any directional moves. Thus, much like volatility swaps, it gives you a simpler and more pure volatility exposure than delta hedging an option does. The payoff of a variance swap is convex in volatility, as you can see on the screen right now. This means that an investor who is long a variance swap will benefit from boosted gains and discounted losses. This bias is reflected in slightly higher strike prices for variance swaps when compared to volatility swaps, a phenomenon which is amplified when volatility skew is steep. The fair value of a variance swap is determined by the cost of the replicating portfolio of options. This cost, especially for index options, is significantly affected by the volatility smile or skew. I've made videos on those as well, which are linked to above. The return calculation for a variance swap on an index does not adjust for any dividend payments that are paid. This means that the dividend modeling method can affect pricing. Long-dated dividends are usually modeled as flat yield and near-dated, and hence either known or relatively certain dividends are modeled discretely, so they're essentially one by one modeled. The payoff of a variance swap is variance notional times the difference between the realized variance and the strike variance. Returns are computed on a logarithmic basis. For variance swaps, instead of using the standard calculation for variance, the contract terms usually set the mean return at zero. The reason for this is that its impact on the price is minimal. The expected average daily return is 1 over 252 of the money market rate, while its omission has the benefit of making the payoff perfectly additive. That means that 3 month variance plus 9 month variance in 3 months time would be equal to 1 year variance. So it's sort of, it just, that simplification in the formula just makes everything a little bit easier. So how do we replicate variance swaps? Well, in order to price variance swaps, we should first look at the replicating portfolio that captures realized variance. The cost of that portfolio should be the fair value of future realized variance. To achieve such a portfolio, you need to combine options of many different strikes. A portfolio of options of all strikes weighted in inverse proportion to the square of the strike level. Each option weighted by 1 divided by its own strike squared gives an exposure to variance that is independent of stock price. Intuitively, as the stock price moves up to higher levels, each additional option of higher strike in the portfolio provides an additional contribution to variance proportional to that strike. It takes an infinite number of strikes appropriately weighted to replicate a variance swap. In practice, this is neither possible nor practical. There are only a certain number of options available at any maturity, and if the stock price moves outside the range of available strikes, the reduced vega of the imperfectly replicated contract will make it less responsive than a true variance swap. As long as the stock price remains within the strike range, trading the imperfectly replicated contract will allow variance to accrue at the correct rate. So it's worth noting that when these things first came out, you were able to trade variance swaps both on indexes and on single stocks. Now, during the credit crunch, markets were extremely, extremely volatile. And so even indexes were swinging around at movements of 10% a day. Single stocks were even more volatile than that. And so what was happening was that banks who had sold or bought or, but were hedging variance swaps using this approach were finding that on single stocks, on a daily basis, the market was moving past the available strike prices, at least for the static hedge when it was first implemented. And so these hedges weren't working very well for single stock variance swaps. And for that reason, these single stocks variance swaps aren't really available anymore. It's much easier to trade index variance, but not really to trade these, simply because the banks that were selling them really just didn't want to be on the other side of that, because the hedge doesn't work very well in extreme markets. So anyhow, how do we price variance swaps? Variance swaps can theoretically be hedged, as I just described, and thus priced as a portfolio of European call and put options with weights inversely proportional to the square of the strike. Care must, however, be taken with regard to the volatility smile, as the wings, and by that I mean deep in and out of the money option prices, can have a disproportionate effect on the price. A volatility smile model is needed to correctly price variance swaps. If we use the Heston model, a closed form solution can be derived for the fair variance swap rate. To learn more about this, take a look at chapter 12 of my book, Trading and Pricing Financial Derivatives, which is linked to in the description below. Okay, well, you made it all the way to the end of the video. So the rules are, as you know, that you have to hit the like button. If you would like to see more videos like this, hit the subscribe button and press the little bell button next to it if you want to be notified every time I upload a video. Tune in tomorrow and we will be starting a series on interest rate swaps. See you then.